So, this is working, right?
Yeah.
Well, technical problems. I think it's nothing new for everybody here. This is the agenda. So we'll start with a little bit introduction. Why reading the actual manual is a good idea. My favorite designer templates. Little bit about project setup. That is the application descriptor. That UI5 is actually enterprise ready. One of the few frameworks that actually deserves the title enterprise ready. And of course, as always, as last, testing, because nobody's actually liking to do it. Just like security, you put it at the end. So, more than code. Actually, this is not a session about learning how to code. There are a lot of nice sessions available here at this event where you can actually go to and learn how to write an application. This is not about this. This is the next step, actually. So, for instance, 5 years after you actually started to learn how to code UI5, yeah, what does it get you? You get a senior UI5 developer. You get a lot of LinkedIn requests. And this session here is actually about the knowledge you gain. Yeah? Basically, the sarcasm after 5 years of failed projects. So let me start it. This is a typical slide I always use. It's really nice to actually get a good understanding about products and how you actually start doing them. Though we have the minimal viable product. Everybody here knows the term of minimal viable product. Nobody. Good. And there we have the minimal lovable product. Yeah? Okay, one person already knows the term. These two are not the same. Yeah, what you get actually with a minimal viable product is a cake, a simple cake, but you actually want for your end users, it's a nice cake. Yeah, it's a Kit Kat cake. The cake actually looks nice. And what you have to understand, what you get with design thinking in your first iterations is a minimal viable product. Good enough to do the job, not good enough to actually get your users excited. Yeah, this is one of the principles of design thinking. You iterate. Yeah. In the later steps, actually, you get the minimal lawful product. But in the first step, it's just like this. Yeah? But your goal actually is go to the nice Kit Kat cake. Everybody likes Kit Kat? Okay. And this is also very important when you're doing a project. You have to learn how to say no. Yeah? You have a project that may be good and fast, but it won't be cheap. So anybody here is actually a customer that actually has to pay the bill. Yeah, please make sure cheap, yeah, good, fast, not cheap. Yeah, if you want it cheap, you get it fast. Yeah, and also you have to really learn how to say no to this kind of requirements. Yeah, you cannot simply go to a customer and always say yes, yes. Yes, yes. You have to be aware that sometimes you have to say no. Yeah. This is very, very important. And also, there is more than just delivering the code. If you're talking about code, we are talking about what actually? We are talking about deliverable, an application. Yeah. But you have to understand that there's so much more, actually, that you have to consider. I mean, you have somewhere in the application lifecycle actually start. Yeah, you have the concept, you have to do design thinking, do a low prototype, go to a high fidelity prototype maybe, talk with end users and so on. You can also do development, you have to test, you have to transport it, you have to support it. Yeah, I mean, you really have to support an application. After delivering it, it's not simply like done. Yeah, I mean, people are going to use it for days, weeks, months, years, it's SAP, decades. Yeah? And all this is actually your actual end-to-end process. And the development, actually, this is most of the sessions you actually get here or online or in other places, it's just a developing. Yeah? As you can see, there's a little bit more to it. And you have to also consider this when you're actually doing your applications. Well, there's not just one dimension of the end-to-end process. You also have like this top Here is like the strategic projects, your basic project, infrastructure projects, and so on. And you also have projects running in parallel. This is this year. It's not. I'm not a designer, so it doesn't look really good. But I try to actually make it easily understandable. But you have several projects going on in parallel. Yeah, and you also have projects going on at different levels. You also have to understand that sometimes you are actually depending on a project that is maybe down here, and another project is depending on you that is on the top. Yeah, so maybe you have a S4 implementation, or you have some project that is going to implement in a business process. So this is like a top. It's a business process actually that is going on, and they depend on you. And at the same time, you may be depending on a project that is doing the infrastructure, like going to the cloud. And you have several projects going on in parallel. And this is also a problem because you're actually also in a competition with resources at a company. And not just like resources of, do we have time to actually deploy it? We also have resources like people. Yeah, maybe you only have like 5 developers and you have 10 projects, so you can do the math. It means your resource won't be available. Yeah, he's busy doing a different project. Yeah, the resource may be on vacation, and then suddenly you cannot deploy anything, or you cannot test, or you cannot, bites me, something else. Now this is what you have to be aligned with, and looking now at the slide, it's maybe not clear, but I hope the animation actually made it clear. So with the manual, I am personally, it's actually filming, right? Can I drop the F-bomb? Read the fucking manual. SAP UI5 or Open UI5 has a really, really good documentation. Who actually has read the documentation of UI5? Hands up, hands up, hands up, hands up, hands up. Oliver, we have to talk. There's a sample part also included with sample applications. Everybody knows this kind of... So first it was hands up, now it's like, okay, everybody knows. And there's also a walkthrough, or there are several walkthroughs right now. Yeah, have you done the walkthroughs? I mean, this is free training. Yeah, it's a great set of documentation SAP has put here together. And all I can say, it's a time saver, it's a life saver. I'm really impressed. Anyone has ever used the documentation of Angular? They have one application they are documenting, and the documentation sucks big time. So I have to say this is really a nice part. Someone here actually is on Twitter. Okay, maybe you have read this post here. There was some post on Twitter about the Stack Overflow keyboard. Yeah, you know Stack Overflow? Good. There's even a tool available on Stack Overflow that allows to insert a problem, and the tool will call Stack Overflow for code samples, compile them, and report if the result actually is working. Yeah, all you need today for developing is Control-CV. Yeah. And I had a podcast with a now ex-UR5 developer. And I was commenting, hey, I really like the documentation because it makes it so easy because you can simply copy-paste stuff. And it's a real time saver. And people were then starting to actually bullying me. Yeah, there's a severe problem in our industry about mobbing. Yeah, I have documented it here. I'm a copy-paste broker. I didn't know, but this is actually an insult. Yeah, I'm proud of it. To give you a small example of the copy-paste, simple form, everybody has used it sometimes. I mean, form-based development in UI5, that is like a synonym. You can see here, it's a form, I have a message strip, and I have the form beneath it. Works perfect. Yeah, I have a two-column layout. And now I have the famous object page layout. Yeah, so copy-paste. Question now, what do you think will actually go happen if I simply copy-paste the code from my simple form? Pretty nice, you have seen it. Yeah. Now into the object page. What do you think? Will it work? Raise your hands. Who thinks it will work? One, two, three. No. The rest is like, yeah. No bet here. Okay. It looks like this. For those acronyms understanding the difference, this is wrong. Yeah? The message chip should be on top and the form should be completely covering the area. Yeah, this is actually because with the object page layout, I get by default a three-column layout. Who knew that? Yeah? Nobody, right? Guess what? It's written in the documentation. Yeah? That was my reaction also after 2 days of actually trying out to figure out why it isn't it working. Yeah? Because it works also if you just put in the form, not the message strip. Yeah? But if you read this and you read the whole documentation, just an extract, it gets clear. So after doing as the documentation demands, it works. Yeah? 2 days wasted of my life, and it gave me like 4 slides. Then you also have my most favorite OData version 4, the model in UI5. Who is using OData version 4? 1, 2, 3. What's your experience? Let's give you a small. Normally, I'm used to doing this kind of session a little bit more interactive. Yeah. So if you have questions or something, just ask. If not, I'm going to ask you. So, Leo, what was your experience? Oh, yeah. He thinks it is nice. He's using it in the CAP programming model. Who knows CAP, the Cloud Application Programming Model? You really have to check it out. It's cool stuff. Who knows OData version 2 batch processing in ABAP? Okay, can I drop the F-bomb again? This thing is fucking complicated to implement, right? CAP actually does it on the Node.js side by default. You get batch processing by default. You have to do absolutely nothing. It's just defining your CDS and you're fine. But now, OData version 4. So what do we get? Events. Yeah? Request completed. Not supported. Request failed. Not supported. Request sent. Not supported. Could. Create, read, update, delete. Not supported. Get data, get object, blah, blah, get property. Everything is not supported. It's written in the documentation, yeah? So documentation tells you what is actually available and what not. It even explains why it is not supported. But in the end, for you as a developer, it means not supported. Looking at Oliver's face, it's like, yeah, good. Were you responsible for OData version 4? Good reaction. So, again, this is not bad, actually. Yeah? I mean, SAP did it with a reason. Yeah, people were actually thinking about it. Thinking, yeah? It doesn't mean that they came to the right conclusion. It means they were thinking about it. And the idea is actually to do for simplification. SAP simplification, you know? S4, simplification? Same kind of simplification. It makes life a little bit more complicated. For instance, now you should actually access the data via the UI controls and not directly via the JavaScript. Makes sense. Yeah. Problem is, it actually means that you have to rethink your applications when you have a version 2 model and you want to go to version 4. It's not just like simply changing the backend service and you are good to go. You will have to redevelop some part of the application at least. I guess this is one of the reasons why you actually can also use Fiori elements, because in theory it should be a less complicated migration. But for everybody that is actually right on OData version 2, be aware this is not the same as with OData version 4. There are more things going to change than just your backend service. And if you can, please do yourself a favor. Stick to version 2. I guess we will see a lot of new features coming to version 4 maybe in the next year. Right now, it's nice to have, but if you can, skip it. Then you also have like API management. Somebody here actually has done API management from you. Yeah, API, the SAP API management. What was the old name? Apigee. Someone tried out Apigee once. Azure API, nobody, okay. What you normally do is actually this here. You have your app, you have a reverse proxy, and you make your backend services available because browsers do not like cores. Yeah? So they have to make sure that you actually can access your services with a different domain where your service is running. API management actually does basically the same, just that it also adds a little bit more features to it. For instance, you can bundle your APIs into a certain product. Yeah? So your backend guys are actually responsible for the service. They can tell you if you want to use product service, these are the services you need to use our product service. Yeah? You do not have to find out anymore. just leaving? And you can also add additional control mechanisms or monitoring on top of this kind of services. For instance, you can monitor if the service is up or down, response times, how many requests are actually coming in, coming out. You can add additional security features like the API key. Yeah, you can secure also your API. And you can also add a price tag to it. So you can say 1,000 invocations will cost the cost center of HR $1, something like that. So if you're ever going to figure out if your service is actually used, you can use API management, and it helps you to find out better if the service is used or not. It's not solving a lot of problems. It makes life a little bit easier. Specifically, the API key that you can set into the HTTP header, as it also is going to secure your API. So for instance, cloud providers, Azure and so on, they are using this a lot to actually secure their services. Just not when you're using OData version 4. You cannot set a custom HTTP header. But it looks nice, as you can see here. I mean, this is just a live service we actually have running. It's for a demo application with Microsoft. And you get this kind of information out of the box without having to do anything. Yeah. But don't ask me why everything is actually red, if it's going down. Sometimes it's green, red. But it actually gives you a lot of insight. You can also see how many requests you were receiving. And yeah. And this helps actually a lot if you have a lot of services to figure out if you can deprecate a service or not. So back to UI5 documentation. This is now about the UI5 documentation. I mean, it's really a great resource. And if you're going to use it, it's read, try, understand, repeat. The order is important. First, read the documentation, then try it out. Then you actually be able to understand it. And then you can go up to the next section. If you're first, try it out and then read, then you will actually lose a lot of time because you won't understand why it's happening and sometimes working, sometimes not. Yeah? Documentation is really feature complete at that part. And it also helps you to actually, if you're using the documentation, to automatically use via copy-paste the patterns and best practices from UI5. Yeah? Then continuously integration. Who's running a pipeline? One. Three, four, wow. So we have less than 5% of the users here are using pipelines. The nice thing is if you set it up once, actually it is a real time saver. Don't think that it's easy to set up. Yeah, your first runs you have with your pipeline means actually it won't build, it gives you problems, you have to add features and so on. Though it maybe take longer than AKDs to actually have a working pipeline. Yeah? Sometimes it takes you maybe a month. But when you have it, someone maybe it was also in the Karma session, UI5 Karma session, you can also run your tests automatically. And if you do everything right, you get 100% code coverage. Yeah. This is actually when it is working and you're really happy. So what is going to happen actually with your pipeline in the end is Sometime you're actually going to deliver your project, like day 45, you are done. 100 days later, you have a feature request and you have to implement it, and your pipeline won't work anymore. Or maybe 200 days, yeah, or maybe one day. But you have to be sure, sometime in the future, your pipeline will actually stop working. It will happen. Yeah. So make sure that you're actually going to test your pipeline on a daily basis. Yeah. I mean, you have invested money in having a pipeline. Continuous integration means continuously. Yeah. At least into development, you should be able to deploy it on a regular basis. Daily or maybe weekly. Yeah, but it should not be a problem. So if someone is like, I cannot use my pipeline on a daily basis because I cannot deploy it on a daily basis because I need someone on the basis side to actually deploy it, you do not have a pipeline because you're not able to actually deploy stuff into at least development. Yeah. It also means you may have invested money into getting a pipeline, but in the end, you do not have a pipeline, though. You have invested into what, actually? Yeah, into nothing. Yeah. It's nice to have it. It's typical, like, management wants to have, or some technical leader wants to have a pipeline. You can deliver it, but if you're not actually testing it daily, you do not have a pipeline. Although UI5 evolution, a huge topic the last year at least, the year before, I'm not sure, use what the UI tooling is actually giving you. Yeah. One of the nice features you get out of the box with the UI5 tooling is you get a basic reverse proxy. Yeah. You just have to put into your manifest JSON like this here. This is what the UI5 server is running, proxy, and then your target. Yeah. You get this out of the box. You do not have to actually set up a reverse proxy on running this stuff. Yeah, you get it from UI5. Yeah. Dumb coding? No. Not today. Designer templates. Who's a designer? You're not. Sven. No, you're. So, designer took this from our webpage because that's a resource that I can use without having to pay money. Imagine you get something like this from a designer and saying, I want to have this on the detail page, for instance, or on the main page. Yeah, this is actually what you always get. And the first question is always, nice. What's the font type? Yeah, what's the size? What's the margins? What's the colors? Yeah, if you just get a PDF or a JPEG, you have no idea actually what the designer was thinking about it. Is it the tablet version? Is it the desktop version? Is it the mobile version? Is it Yeah, it's just like an image, yeah. And this is simply not enough. You need more information, and the designer actually he gets all the paid money from the customer, so he should actually be able to deliver all this kind of information, without you having to ask him or her. Yeah, and this is something you should actually never accept. I know this is a dream. Yeah, you will get something like this. You have to accept it, but also be sure that this is something I refer to as a Forrest Gump design. Why? You get like a box of chocolate. Yeah, and this is an image from Lederach, from the website. It costs, this box costs 85 Schweizer Franken. That's all you get. Yeah, it's one picture, and the rest is just like the ingredients, if you are allergic against it or not. I have no idea what is the exchange rate right now for 85 Schweizer Franken to Euro. But it's not so cheap, for sure, right? And this is what you get. I mean, it's not even a nice picture that showing if it's one layer, two layers, or what's in it. Yeah. And this is actually what you can get when you go to Amazon and buying some chocolate from some unknown chocolate dealer. And as you can see, you actually get like a nice picture explaining the layout. You get the front page, the back page, the ingredients. You know actually what is in there. You also get all the ingredients list for the allergics. And you also get like the size of the box. This costs, I have no idea, €7, active 5 Schweizer Franken. Yeah. And actually what you want to have when you have to design an application is a detailed specification like on the right. Yeah. What you want to have as a customer or something, maybe it's this, but actually what you need is on the right side. Yeah. So, if you can, yeah, enforce the designers to actually use the tools SAP provides, Open UI5 provides. There are stencils available for PowerPoint, for Azure, Azure, I forgot the name. There is build available. Build is still available, right? It's still alive. Okay. You have build. Yeah, it helps a lot because you actually can create applications, mockups, and so on already in UI5 elements. Also, you should be aware the sweet spot for UI5 is what? Business applications. Yeah, so form-based. SAP made a lot of money with form-based applications. Have you ever worked with WebGimpro at the time back with tables? It's incredible the amount of table alternatives SAP gives you. This is the reason because it's about displaying information in a way that actually makes it easy for users to understand. This is a sweet spot also for UI5 applications. Yeah, so don't try this with UI5. Yeah, yeah, you're laughing, but in the end, this site is actually pretty amazing. Yeah, first you get like real-time information. Yeah, the it looks like broken, but I think they actually make this overlapping intentionally. Yeah, you have a lot of information here, and also actually finding out the details of a car is very easy. You just click on it, it's one page, you scroll it down, and they even make a very smart move in the presentation of the leasing rates, because they are just saying, how much does it cost? And they make a comparison to like, it costs to like 3 Big Macs a day. Yeah, this is actually pretty good, yeah? Because you're talking to the users in a language they understand. Yeah. But this is not the focus for UI5. Yeah? Look at the background. Wow. Though application description, also very important before you actually start developing an application is find out what the application is intended to do and where the application is going to live. Is it a standalone application? Is it an application for the Fiori Launchpad? Is it an application that's going to be a mobile app? Yeah, because you can not simply go from a mobile app to a standalone app. Yeah, if you start with developing for offline features, for a camera, for uploads of files and so on, and then you want to move this into a standalone app, you have a lot of issues actually to solve. Yeah, so and vice versa also. You can start with a standalone app. It's easy to make it a launchpad app, but then go to mobile app, it's a different level. You have to first actually find out what you want to do. Yeah. Another step before you actually set up your project is a very easy question like, who are these people in the room? Yeah. Who is actually doing what? Yeah. Who is the basis guy? Who is the designer? Who's going to write the tests? Who's going to write the application? Who's going to do the design? And sometimes, in most of the cases, the question, of course, is you. Yeah? But sometimes you also have more than one person, so it makes sense to actually find out responsibilities. Yeah? Also, very important is how do you actually onboard new members to a project? In my normal case, it's like, we have a new member on the project. Who? The guy was sitting there. He got his key to his laptop. Now have fun. This is not onboarding. Yeah? You have to define actually a process or how you can onboard a person. Also, the documentation, of course, you have wiki issue trackers and so on. But make sure that the information you need is available to the right persons at the right time. And Jira doesn't mean that you're agile. This is very important. It's just a tool. Also consider the bus factor. You know the bus factor calculation? How many people does it take to be rolled over by a bus until my project is actually at stake? Now, you have one developer. He goes out on the street. He's rolled over by a bus. Then I do have a problem, right? If I have 10 developers, one gets actually into hospital or killed by the bus, I shouldn't have a problem. Yeah. But also means if you have 10 people on the project and one is doing the development and nine are doing nothing, and the one guy is actually being killed, you still have a problem. Yeah. I'm going to skip this a little bit and go to documentation. Architecture documentation. You know, onboarding, you actually want to figure out how the app is working in a larger picture. And normally you get nothing. Yeah, who's doing still documentation of the architecture landscape in Microsoft VSU? That's good. Nobody. But you also have to make sure that the documentation you are providing is easily accessible. So you can actually put it into your repository, into your README MD or your wiki you're using. And you can use something like Mermaid. That is a tool that helps you to define this kind of graphics in a text editor. And you can use this tool to actually document your landscape. Like I have an iOS device, I have the SAP cloud, and I have SAP backend. Or you make it a little bit more complicated. Yeah. But as you can see, it's just text you actually have to write here. Yeah. Doesn't need to be the developer that is doing this. Yeah. Project manager can also do something useful in the project. Let me do like this. Yeah, or here, a different graph, yeah, with a decision in it. Yeah. And something very important nobody's using because it's already old when you release it, a sequence diagram. Yeah. Doing something here, analyze, go back, and so on. And you do not have to use like PowerPoint for this to design. You can use a tool, text editor. Should also make it easier to maintain it because you do not need Microsoft VSU or another tool or a license or something to be able to open the proprietary archive. This is text. Also, someone wants to take a picture still? This is a Mermaid.js. I am using GitLab. It's included there. Yeah. Yeah. Although, important part is always the team evolution. You know it. Project starts, money is there. Everybody is still excited. Everybody is totally happy. This is Monday. And on Tuesday, all of the project starts. So we have first team members already leaving. Another ones are entering. Size already reduced, but everything is still okay. Then you actually go on and go on. You deliver, you go into maintenance of the whole stuff. You find out only two survivors. Yeah, but still, everything is actually okay, more or less. And then you go into support. So the last person are already leaving, and you have the support person coming new to the project. You know, he has no traces in the project, did nothing. He just answered an email from his manager, hey, I have a nice project for you. Huh? What? And already has a WebEx call with the customer, and he has to take over the project. Yeah. Normal, and you have a problem. Yeah, because that person now, that was not involved actually in the overall project, is now responsible for maintaining it and attending support calls. Poor guy. Yeah, just give you a more small example. This is a GitHub example of me. For me, 7 years ago, I did something with SUP web services on, I think, Geronimo. SUP is not standard paddling. This is the old Cybus Unwire platform 7 years ago. And when I was looking at the source code, I was like, yeah, bites me, what did I do 7 years ago? I have no idea, there's no documentation. And imagine now you're coming on new to a project, we have nothing done yet, and people are handing over you just like the source code. That's fun, right? Yeah, so Because of this, put everything you can actually into your repository. Document as much as possible. Do not hide information that may be useful in a ticket system. A ticket system is about the why. Why am I doing it? Because there's a problem, a customer requests something. The how I'm doing it, the doing actually, to understand the code, put it into your repository. Put it into the README, put it into a doc folder, put it into, I don't know, but put it somewhere. Also enterprise ready, just back to the very nice feature of UI5, semantic versioning. If you know it, it's actually pretty nice because we have one version one, still not a version two. It also means as long as SAP is not going to release a version two, your code actually will continue to work even with newer UI5 versions. So if you one day we have 1.500, your code you have written like 5 years ago should still work. Correct, Oliver?
Correct.
Here's added. This really means UI5 is enterprise ready. I took here an example. The first commit from Mats, one of the UI5 guys, Matthias. He made a sample application. You should actually also download this kind of application, take a look at it, it's very good. And he made the first commit of this like 5 years ago, when UI5 was open sourced. Just a small reminder, 5 years ago, we were still already developing five years ago with UI5, one person. Two, three. Oh, shit, we are old. Well, there was a manifest from JSON. You have put this in your component JS. There was no UI5 inspector. I have no idea about how we're actually doing development without UI5 inspector. There were no walkthroughs, no tutorials, nothing. It was UI5 for real man. But it works still today. Someone still remembers the SAP Blue Crystal theme? Looks really ugly. Once in a time, this was like, wow. It was like you open up the launchpad the first time with this theme. And it was like, wow, a new world is actually going to start. Today, it's like, wow. But it works. The app looks old, but the app works. Try this with Angular. No way. Just to give you a small time traveling, 2014, FIFA World Cup champion, Germany, Rio de Janeiro, we won it. iOS was Objective-C. I still don't know any more Objective-C. And 2019, let's skip the FIFA World Cup champion. And iOS, we have Swift. In Android, we have Kotlin. Angular is version 8. I think Angular actually is doing UI5 a favor. Also versions, UI5 is not going to increment. Angular is doing. And also on the roadmap level, 5 years actually is a lot of time. But important here is actually if it still works, it's enterprise ready. Be happy that your app is still working. But also take a look after it from time to time. And enterprise ready is not about actually having a box with your signature on it. Who knows Silicon Valley? It also means that you're actually going to lock your stuff. And there's a nice logger framework from UI5. Don't use console.logged. JSLint doesn't like it. And you also have to measure your stuff. Measuring the application, once again, for the customers, faster is not a number. I want to have it faster. Nice. Now it is faster. You need something actually to measure. Here I'm using Elastic APM, distributed logging. And actually, you can include this very easily into your application. And it actually tells you how much time you are spending in a transaction. And this is not a really good example, actually, because it's like 73 milliseconds. But you can use this to say one transaction is want to create a purchase order. And this tool can help you to understand where is the time actually being lost. Yeah, takes a lot of time for the page to be created. There's a lot of time to read the information from the backend. Or does the user simply take 1 minute to fill out the purchase order? And then you actually also can figure out, why does it take 1 minute to fill out the information? Is there too much information on the screen? Yeah, or this is a good number, or this is a bad number? Yeah, and this kind of distributed tracing actually helps you to identify where the problem is occurring. We can also find out here, okay, my backend is really fast, so my backend is not a problem. You can also take a look, this is using CAP. In the future, you can use it to also monitor a PostgreSQL database, so you can figure out, is the database a problem or not? Yeah, maybe sometime in the future, it's possible to include this with HANA, then you can find out if HANA is a problem or not. And this is a real world application that I developed. You have an iOS application and a UI5 application. It even uses GeoMaps as a feature with Bing Maps. In that case, I have to say documentation from UI5 really sucks. Yeah, but there's an open source course available that explains you how to do it. Yeah, you only have to go through, I believe it was a 3-week course, and then you know how to create maps. Yeah, not really intuitive because there are some license problems, though there's no copy-paste possible. But there's an open UI5, open SAP course available and can teach you how to do this. So what's a nice feature of that application actually? Yeah, some people forget this a little bit, but you can use open UI5 not only with an SAP backend. You do not need to have a gateway system. You do not need to have an S4 system. Yeah, you also can use anything and put it into a classic VM. And with CAP, it's even simpler. Yeah, you can also create it on a VM. You can scale it. Yeah, and if you want, you can actually deploy it into your HANA system. 5 minutes. You can also put it into a Docker container. Yeah, someone here already is playing around with Docker? A little, okay. Well, Docker, learning Docker is easy. It gets complicated with Kubernetes. And a whole different level of pain in the ass. And you can also use CAP actually to deploy it on Kubernetes and deploy it on demand if you still need it onto a HANA database. But it also means that you are freer to actually explore possibilities. Yeah. Just as a reminder, use CAPM or CAP, SAP is telling it. It's a Node.js application. You only need to install NPM, the SAP repository, and NPM install CDS. What's a nice feature of this actually is, once you have it running in Kubernetes, you gain all the benefits of the cloud. Yeah, for instance, this is like the minimum requirement at Azure to run in a VM with Kubernetes, 7 GB, 2 virtual CPUs. But if you want to increase it because you get more and more users actually using your service or you're successful, all you have to do is actually put your mouse here, click, track it to here, click. And you have like 200 virtual CPUs and 1700 gigabytes of memory available. Yeah, so scaling with Kubernetes and the cloud is really easy. Yeah. Small benefit also that you can implement with UI5, you are not bound to a old data, you can also use JSON. If you use a JSON model, you can also include different services from different cloud providers. Yeah. You can use, of course, SAP, no problem, but you can also say, oh, I'm already a Google customer, I'm already an Azure customer, I already have a service there. There's no problem, you can integrate it. And if you want, you can also use an API management service like SAP API Management to integrate this in a central place. You can also monitor it. So testing, favorite topic for everybody here, right? We do testing just like SAP. We test in production. Vantage, the error you found here actually really is an error because it has an impact. Yeah, it's the end user that is finding it out. And also, I think you can also sell it like customer engagement. Yeah? Because you're really close with the customer when you're actually screwing up the system in production. But this is not only like, oh my God, we're going to test in production. The point here is actually you need to also make sure that your systems or your test stuff actually reflects production. Yeah, also when you have a production system with like 1,000 line items and you're only testing it with 3 line items, makes no sense. Yeah, you have to also reflect actually your production system in your test system or what you're going to test. Yeah, once I had a case where testing was done in Chrome, worked perfectly, application was shipped, customer was only using Internet Explorer. Guess what? Didn't work. Yeah. But everybody from the developer side was surprised. Yeah. And they didn't accept the answer. Here are the basic rules for testing. Yeah, I mean, just do it. One test case is better than nothing. Yeah. Which reminds me of some old test cases I found in standard code from a specific company I won't mention, where they were testing if 1 == 1 you're good to go. Why did they test? Because the test infrastructure was configured to only let the code through if you had actually tests in it. You have to know how the system works to play it. Yeah? I just was mentioning outside, new way for playing around with CVs is that you actually write, I believe in Spiegel Online, that people are now writing in white, color font white, into their CV hidden, top or something, that they were like going to Harvard, that they are professor, that they are, I don't know, super genius, have an IQ of 300. System is going to read it. Because it's machine learning, analyzing it, and suddenly you get popping up in the request from the HR. Because you are like a professor with 5 doctorates, I don't know. But you have to know how to play the system. Yeah? Although knowing how to play the system is OPF5 is fine, if you have the time to actually develop OPF5. I don't like it. I think it's too much code. That doesn't return a lot. Yeah, I have to write too much, but that's just me. I'm using a WebDriver IO, or Selenium, because there also I'm writing against what the user is seeing. Yeah, I write a test against the web browser. And I can use this stuff also to deploy it to several cloud providers if I want to, and also can say, now run this test on Firefox, Chrome, Internet Explorer, simultaneously. Yeah. And in the end, you can go actually to 100% code coverage. Just let me show this. But just be aware, this is just a number. Yeah. I mean, managers like it, yeah, or reporter managers or project managers. They want to have like a specific number of code coverage. I had Sonar Cube systems configured for 90% code coverage. Yeah, because they were taking the code coverage metrics from Java. And then you have an UI5 application, a code coverage of 90%. Yeah, it's possible, but I think it's not worth the effort. And also, just because you have 100% code coverage actually does not mean that you are bug-free. It just means that you are running through your code. Yeah, that's the difference. I mean, it's nice, yeah, but don't go for 100% code coverage. Yeah, if you have a library, yes, that library you may test for 100% code coverage because it's a library. But if you have 500 lines of code in your fuse, your fuse controller, do you really want to mock everything to just have 100% code coverage of your fuse controller? I think it makes more sense to actually go for the button, click the button, and check if the table is actually filled with values. Yeah. And I think I'm on time. Oh? Almost. Questions? What do you think?